bitch, now get the hell away from here. Harrogate wandered on up the aisle. Some of the bunks had pillows as well as blankets. He picked one up that had only a bare tick and climbed up and spread his blanket and sat in the middle of it. He sat there for a while, and then he climbed down again and went to the bars and peered out. Someone in a suit like his was coming backward down the hallway, towing a bucket on wheels by a mop submerged in the black cloth it held. He glanced at Harrogate as he went past, a cigarette in the corner of his mouth. He didn't look friendly. Across the hall, another prisoner was peering from his cage. Harrogate studied him for a minute. Then he gave sort of a crazy little wave at him.
"Aye,"
he said.
"Sure,"
said the other prisoner. Harrogate turned and went back and climbed into his bunk and lay staring at the ceiling. Concrete beams painted green. A few half-blackened light bulbs screwed into the masonry. It had grown dim within the room, the early winter twilight closing down the day. He slept. When he woke, it was dark out, and the bulbs in the ceiling suffused the room with a sulphurous light. Harrogate sat up. Men were filing into the cell with a sort of constrained rowdiness, not quite jostling one another, lighting or rolling cigarettes, speaking only once they were inside. A rising exchange of repartee and shaded insult. Once by Harrogate, where he sat up in his cot like a ground squirrel and pointed him out.
"Looky here, new blood."
They filed past. Toward the end came men hobbling with what looked like the heads of pickaxes welded about one ankle. The door clanged. Keys rattled. Two men turned in at the bunks beneath Harrogate. One of them lay down and closed his eyes for a minute, and then sat up and shucked off his shoes and lay back and closed his eyes again. The other stood with his head bent a few inches from Harrogate's knee and began to unload his pockets of various things. A pencil stub, matchbooks, a beer can opener, a flat black stone, a sack of tobacco. He saw Harrogate watching him and looked up. "Hey," he said.
"Hey,"
said Harrogate. "You don't piss in the bed, do you?"
"No, sir."
"Do you smoke?"
"I used to some, before I got thrown in the jailhouse and couldn't get an errand."
"Here." He pitched the sack of tobacco up onto Harrogate's blanket. Harrogate immediately opened the sack and took a paper from the little pocket under the label and began to roll a cigarette. "You get one of those every week," the man said.
"When do I get mine?"
"Next week."
"You ain't got no match, have you?"
"Here." Harrogate lit the cigarette and sucked deeply and blew out the match and put it in his cup. "Keep." He put the matches in his pocket.
"How old are you?"
18.
18?
"Yes, sir."
"You just made it, didn't you?"
"That's what they keep telling me."
"What's your name?"
"Jim Harrogate."
"Harrogate," the man said. He had one elbow on the upper bunk and was holding his chin in his fingers, studying the new prisoner with a rather detached air. "Well," he said, "my name's Sutry."
"Hi, Mr. Sutry."
"Just Sutry." "What are you in for?"
"Stealing Warren Reynolds."
"That's bullshit. What are you in for?"
"I got caught in a watermelon patch."
"With what? A tractor and trailer? They don't send people to the workhouse for stealing a few watermelons. What else did you do?" Harrogate sucked up a cigarette and looked at the green walls.
"Well," he said, "I got shot."
"Got shot?"
"Yeah."
"Whereabouts?"
"Yeah, I know. In a watermelon patch. Where did you get hit?"
"Pretty near all over." "What with? Shotgun?"
"Yeah."
"For stealing watermelons?"
"Yeah."
Sutry sat down on the lower bunk and put one foot up and began to rub his ankle. After a while, he looked up.
shoot somebody for stealing a few water pellets, he said. I don't know. He came out to the hospital and brought me a ice cream. I didn't much blame him. He said himself he wished he'd not done it. Didn't keep him from pressing charges, though, did it? Well, I guess, seeing as he'd done shot me, he couldn't back out. Sutry looked at the boy again with this remark, but the boy's face was bland and without device. He wanted to know when supper was served. 5 o'clock. Should be in a few minutes. Do the thing good? You'll have time to get used to it. What did you draw, anyway? 11:29. Oh, 11:29. Boy, that beat good in that hospital. Best you ever ate. Couldn't you have run off from there? I never had no clothes. I thought about it, but I didn't have stitch one, nor no way to come by any. I'd rather to be in a workhouse than get caught out wearing one of them old crazy nightshirts they make you wear. Wouldn't you? No. Well, that's you. That's me. Harrogate looked down at him, but he had his eyes closed. He rolled back over and stared at the ceiling. Someone had written a few sentiments there, but they were lost in the glare of the light bulbs. After a while, he heard a bell clang somewhere. A guard came to the door and opened it, and when Harrogate sat up, he saw that the prisoners were shaping up, ready to leave, and he hopped from the bunk and shaped up with them. They marched down the concrete stairs and turned through a door and filed through a mess hall where picnic tables ran the length of the room. They were cobbled up out of oak flooring and had the benches bolted to them. At the end of the mess hall, the prisoners turned into the kitchen where each man got a tin plate and a large spoon. They filed past a steam table where the kitchen helped likewise in strikes, ladled up smoking pinto beans, cabbage, potatoes, hot rounds of cornbread. Harrogate had his thumb in his mouth and got hot cabbage spooned over it by a smiling black man. He said, "Yow!" Swapped hands and stuck the thumb in his mouth. A guard came over and looked down at him. "Was that you?" he said. "Yes, sir." "One more holler out of you and you get no supper." "Yes, sir." Nearby, prisoners wore pinched faces, apparently in pain, eyes half shut with joy constrained. Harrogate followed on into a mess hall like the one they'd come through. The benches and tables were filling up with prisoners. He sought out Sutry and sat next to him and fell to with his spoon. A great clanking and scraping throughout the hall, and no word spoke. The table across from them was taken by black prisoners, and Harrogate eyed them narrowly from under his brows, his head bent over his plate and the spoon he gripped like a trowel, rising and falling woodenly. When his group had all done eating, the guard walked along behind them to the head of the table and rapped, and they rose and filed back through the kitchen, scraping their plates into a slop can and stacking them on a table, dropping their spoons into a bucket. Then they filed out through the other mess hall, now partly filled with prisoners eating, and into the hall and up the stairs to their cell again. "There wasn't no meat," said Harrogate. "That's right," said Sutry. "Do they ever have meat?" "I don't know." "Have you ever eaten any meat here?" "You mean other than breakfast bacon?" "Yeah, other than breakfast bacon." "No." Harrogate leaned against the bunk. After a while, he said, "How long you been here?" "About 5 months." "They held fire," said Harrogate. It was dark when they rose in the morning, and dark when they filed into the kitchen to get their plates and spoons, and still dark when they turned out into the dew bowl and graininess of the yard. He stood there with his sleeves and cuffs rolled 2 turns each and watched the men climb into the trucks. He looked for Sutry, but by the time he saw him, he was already in a truck and the door was shut. Some of the trucks had started to pull away. A guard came over and looked down at him. He stooped with his hands on knees to see into his face. "Who the hell are you?" he said. "Harrogate." The guard nodded his head as if this was the right answer. "Did you get your breakfast?" "Sure did." "Feel like you're ready for a day's work, do you?" "I reckon." "Well, we have a truck over here for you to ride in, if that's all right with you." "This in here?" "Yeah. You don't care, do you?" Harrogate grinned.
myself.
I didn't know which truck I was supposed to go to. Well, no truck was the wrong one.
Sit over here.
This son of a bitch drives like a drunk Indian going after more whiskey.
The truck pumped up gouts of white smoke, and they rushed off into the fog, down the hill and down the winding workhouse road to the highway where the taillights of the other trucks went by tubes like eyes before them in the cool October dawn. The prisoners sat in rows facing each other, jiggling, rolling, some trying to sleep. Harrogate crouched on the bench with his hands beneath his thin legs and watched the floor. There was no conversation. The truck gained speed and the tires sang on the black road. At the first stoplight, a young girl was waiting for a bus at the edge of the road. The prisoners shoved and crowded at the wire mesh door of the truck. She turned to stare out over the barren lots toward houses swimming in the mist. A cold light was leaking across the landscape from the east. Harrogate watched two birds come out of the colorless heavens and alight upon a wire and hook down into the truck, then fly again. They went on. The driver's eyes in the car come up behind them somewhat uneasily at the sight of these striped miscreants. By good daylight, they had crossed the north end of the county and were pulled up at a roadside where a sewer pipe lay unjointed along the selvage of red mud, and where riders from the first truck had already descended into ditches and begun to swim picks. The sun rose and warmed them where they stood waiting tools and orders. The man had to interrogate a pick, stepped back and studied it with it, and took it away again. A few cars eased past, faces of the glass. Men bound for work in the city looking out with no expression at all. The prisoners shuffled and milled about until all had tools and Harrogate stood alone. He had started down into the ditch with naked hands when a guard called to him. "Wait here, men," he said. The guard went away and returned with another man who looked down at Harrogate suspiciously.
"How old are you, son?"
"I'm still 18,
said Harrogate. He had one black tooth in the front of his mouth and he sucked at it nervously. The two men looked at each other. The younger one shrugged.
"I don't know," he said. "Well, hell, take him on back and let company have him. You go on back with Mr. William, you hear?"
"Yes, sir."
"Get in that pickup over yonder and wait," the other man said.
Harrogate nodded and hobbled up the road to the truck and climbed up into the bed and sat there in his outsized togs watching the men in the ditch. He saw Suttree shoveling dirt up over the rim of the excavation, and Suttree looked his way once, sitting there alone in the truck, but he did not nod or gesture. After a while, the guard came up. He motioned to him and opened the door of the truck. "Get up front," he said. Harrogate climbed over the side of the truck and opened the door and got in. There was a speaker hanging by a cord from the dashboard, and there was a pump-action shotgun up in a rack over the rear window. The guard started the truck, glanced down at Harrogate, and pulled away, shaking his head. When Suttree came in that night, the smallest prisoner was not in the cell. He saw him at supper, half obscured behind tottering tiers of pans, smoking a home-rolled cigarette and firing thin pipes of smoke from his nostrils in disgust. He was moved that night to the kitchen cell. When he came to get his blanket, Suttree was lying his head out from under the bunk.
Mr. Callahan, he said. You heard him.
Oh, boy, I said such a line back down. Callahan grinned his gap-toothed grin.
Mr. Callahan's got a lot of pull around here, said Suttree. Ask him if he can do something for you.
Do what?
He wants to get out of the kitchen. He thinks washing dishes is beneath his dignity.
Hellfire, little buddy. You got the best job in the joint.
I don't like it, said Harrogate sullenly. They got me working with a bunch of old cripple fuckers, and I don't know what all.
Especially in the guards' mess, said Callahan.
Guards' mess? God damn, said Suttree.
That's what they promised him, said Callahan.
I guess he don't like steak and gravy, ham, eggs every morning.
Ah, oh, shit,
said Harrogate. It's true, said Suttree.
Hell, Suttree, I don't want to be no goddamn dishwasher. I gotta get up at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, we sleep in here till 5:30.
You get to fuck around in the afternoon, said Callahan. But we don't get done till 7 at night.
Well, if you don't want to work in the guards' mess, ask if they'll put you back on the trucks.
What if they say no?
Say yes.
What happens then?
I guess they beat the shit out of you.
No, they won't. Will they, Red?
Nah. Put you in the hole.
They should get real shitty. Then you go in the box.
Well, that's where they put me.
What is it?
Just a concrete box about 4 feet square.
You ever been in there, Suttree?
No. You're talking to a man that has, though.
What did they put you in there for, Mr. Callahan?
Oh, slapping a little old guard. He slapped a vertebra loose in his neck, said Suttree.
God damn, said Harrogate. When was this?
When was it, Red? 2 years ago?
Something like that. The hellfire. How long have you been in here, Mr. Callahan?
That was another offense, said Suttree. He's been in and out. They don't give you nothing to eat but bread and water, said Callahan. In the box, they don't. I believe you'll like the guards' mess better than the box.
I ain't washing no more goddamn dishes.
Well, said Suttree, that's you.
That's me, said Harrogate.
I think you've lost your rabbit-ass mind, said Callahan.
Maybe. But I'll tell you one thing. I haven't get out of here, I sure as shit ain't coming back again.
I think I even heard Bromo say that one time.
Who's Bromo?
The old guy. He's been in and out of here since 1936.
He was in for that, said Callahan.
He was in the other workhouse before this one was built.
Well,
said Harrogate,
that's him.
Suttree grinned.
That's him, he said.
The crimes of the moonlight, Ellen Mounter followed him in his crimes will. The truth of his doings came in at the door, left up the stairs in the dark. Come morning, the prisoners were seeing this half-fool in a new light. To his elbows in dishwater and wreathed in steam, he watched them file across the kitchen with their plates of biscuits and gravy, nodding, gesturing. He smiled back. They saw him again that night. Lost in his stained and shapeless suit, he appeared not to have moved the day long, nor the stacked pans diminished. After supper, he was returned to them, clutching his blanket before him.
Well, said Suttree, you back?
Yep.
What happened?
I told them I was done fucking with them. They want a dishwasher, they can hunt somebody else, because I ain't it.
What did they say?
They asked me did I want to be hall boy. Said you make a few dollars selling coffee.
A few dollars a year.
That's just what I figured. I told them I didn't want no hall boy bullshit.
So what happened?
Nothing. They just sent me on up.
He stood there with his rat's face and a kind of smug smirk. Suttree shook his head.
Yonder he is, called Callahan.
Watermelon man.
Pumpkins, wasn't it?
Pumpkins. God almighty.
Yeah,
Slusser turned in his bunk, raising his leg to clear the rear tine of the pick, then sought out the source of the noise.